has been organized jointly by Comune di Milano, Politecnico di Milano, Parco Nord, Parco, Sud, Parco Agricolo Sud Milano, Bosco in Città e Città Metropolitana. Un ringraziamento speciale va ai nostri sponsor, che sono Fondazione Falck e Sistemi Urbani, che ci permettono di presentare questo lavoro e ci sostengono per tutta la ricerca. L'idea è di avere una presentazione del lavoro in inglese e poi avere presentazioni delle specifici progetti in italiano, ma se c'è un pubblico molto inglese cerchiamo di avere la traduzione. Se ci date un'idea di quanti sono stranieri che non capiscono italiano? How many English speakers who don't understand? Ok. A while. So, we will have maybe the translation after presentation in Italian, or if some of you can present in English. Without further waiting, I'll introduce firstly Dr. Piero Pellizzaro, who is our coordinator for the research, who's going to introduce the why of urban forestry.
Good afternoon, everybody. First of all, let me bring the greetings from the Deputy Mayor Francesco Mara, who is politically leading this important program for the city of Milan, the city of Milan for the metropolitan area of Milan itself. So I will try to briefly describe why we need and why it's necessary that all the metropolitan area and the city of Milan need to improve the capability to more natural based solution. I'm going through a short presentation that brings some demographic changes. So the first element why we need a urban forest is not only environment, is not only climate change, is the changing in the kind of the society the city is facing. The city of Milan, between now and 2030, we will have plus 12,000 over 85 people living in the city. So the city is becoming older and older. What does it mean? It means that in a time of changing climate, where the temperature is increasing, having this environment that is going to be more cool, it will be more accessible, more livable, could help elderly people to better enjoy their life without using air conditioning, for example. That is also one of the causes of climate change in air conditioning. At the same time, the city of Milan is facing an increase of 30,000 people coming every year living in the city. So since now, until 2030, we will have 300,000 people living in the city of Milan, more than nowadays. So now we are 1.3 million, that become 3.2 million in the metropolitan area. You have to add 300,000 people living in the city more in 2030. It's the challenge. Among these, we will have over 50,000 younger generation between 19 and 34 living in the city. Again, the young generation, and this is the hope of our society, is a society that is in Milan, they start living without cars, using bike, walk, using the sharing and mobility. I give you interesting information about the city of Milan. The city of Milan and the everyday transport system, 57% of the transport system is on public transport, 13% is walking. So altogether, 70% of our population decide not to use the cars by using public transport and walking. And this is an important element with how we design the city in the future to make a bus stop or a walking side or a bike line more comfortable and more even helpful for the population. Thanks a lot. At the same time, we have made during the last few months what we call the local climate profile. So we are looking at the impact of climate change at the local scale. So we love polar bear, we love the impact of climate change in the sea level rise, but we need to understand what is happening in Milan. Together with the Politecnico of Milano, together with the Bloomberg Gas Society, together with the ARPA, the Regional Environmental Protection Agency of Lombardy and the Emilia Romagna, we are starting drafting which is the impact of the climate change. And what it comes that the temperature of Milan has increased of 2 degrees. So it's not 1.2 or 1.3 or 4 for the normal UCC7, but the city of Milan, we have an increasing temperature of 2 degrees. And even more important, advantage in terms of comfort. And how we can face it? Retrofitting the house? Yes. But can we also try to cool down the city using green areas and using the tree? One of the first elements that the research was delivered is to say that if we plant at least 3 million trees in the city, in the metropolitan area, we can decrease the temperature of the city to 2 degrees. So basically, that 3 million trees, that actually is one tree per person, so it's not a huge number if we all of us would plant a tree, we can reduce and we can become a climate neutral city. Just 2 days ago, the European Commission has launched the new climate neutral 2015 strategy. So, as is asking to all the territory to become climate neutral, so to try to reduce or at least to mitigate the increase of the temperature of the city. Other issues the city is facing. Since 2008, the city of Milan has seen an increasing presence of water, the groundwater. Why? A lot of private companies closed because of the economic crisis. And there was a company that was water intensive, that was taking the water from the ground. Then, in a time of changing climate, when the normal rain, normally raining 2 months, is happening in 2 days, the fish from the sky and from the ground, it makes the cities more affected, more exposed to flooding events. And the other important step that we need to take is to reduce the presence of concrete and reduce the consumption of soil. Well, what we are doing at the moment within the new review of the PGT, the Piano Governmental Territorio, for English speaker, it was supposed to name the master plan, we are decreasing the use of soil from 74% to 70%. Basically, we are protecting the agricultural soil that now is agriculture, and we are going to keep the agricultural soil as it is. So not going to build new infrastructures, new building, or something. So I think it's an important aim that the city is reaching, is to look for the generation of the existing areas to build the environment and not to new soil. And this -4% gives us a huge opportunity to improve the capacity of planting trees or creating natural resolution the proper way. I will say natural resolution, but then I will leave to Paola, my colleagues at the Green Department, to give some example of phytoremediation process or other like wetland that is present in the city that the other communities to power or the dogs. So is the next this is to the hydrological risk that we have for this. The city of Milan has at the moment 25,000 square meters, million cameras that is probably on site of Cuba Green, that is important. But these elements are essential for us. It's not the only element that we are having in the cities. Another important element for the city and for the metropolitan area is to move to look out of the box for greening. The city of Milan has 24 million square meters of roof. Potentially, 10 million of these are potentially green roofs, because we already have 1 million square meters of green roof in the city. And was done by the community without any kind of initiatives, without any kind of support by the city. So in the new PGT, there will be new regulation in charge to improve the capacity and to make it mandatory also that for all new buildings, green roof should be part of the design process itself. And at the moment, we have public funding initiative schemes for energy efficiency. Out is 24 million of public money to first change the heating system, moving from fossil fuel to more renewable. So we are looking at the low entropy technology, so using the water of the underground waters as a source for heating, so it's also helped to reduce the hydrological risk. But at the same time, the initiative schemes is looking to promote the green roof. So we are now supporting community buildings that want to create green roof. Green roof is not only an element of improving the greening, the capacity of drainage, is also an element to improve the social aspect of the cities. Because in the 15, the 60s, we'll go back in our memory, the roofs were used for people like to dry their clothes and so on, and there was a place where the community, the people living together, have to talk, to be, to live. has objective to improve the capacity of the cities and greening the cities, to reduce the temperature, but at the same time is to make the cities more circular in terms of use of resources. Because circular economy and all the greening is measure huge opportunities. One example, when we speak about tree, it's not only tree that we normally call, it could be also fruit or food tree. There is one startup that was funded by the city of Milan a few years ago, it's named Orange Fiber. Orange fiber is producing textile using orange skin. So basically they take the organic waste and they produce out of orange, of the organic waste, textile. Now, where is this textile? Salvatore Ferragamo, I forget all of you know, are using 30% of this textile. It comes from organic waste. And why the city is looking at this opportunity? Because we in the city of Milan, we are collecting 65% of organic waste and door to door. So we're also looking how we can make out of what was before organic waste and new resources and improving the urban metabolism of the city. That is lead to the urban forest as well program, because we need to also thinking at how when we plant, how we design the green, to then the green has to make maintenance and how these resources would become an opportunity. Just to give a chance to my colleagues. Colleagues from Cambridge, for example, they are investing in the urban forest and using and looking how the wood and the good comes from the forest as an opportunity to create new urban design, so to have new urban furniture using the wood that we can create through the urban forest program. I say the wood because unlikely a few weeks ago, due to a storm that affected the city of Milan normally has no wind, that is quite famous, right? We have wind at 120 kilometers per hour in the cities, and let's say how many horsepower, like 250 trees fall down because of the wind. That has become an issue. I mean, I'm as many people, I'm still shocked what happened in the mountain and what was the UNESCO heritage we lost for our community. And how we can use that food as an opportunity is part of the strategy, because everything is linked. And we cannot consider the urban forest as one single pillar, but how the urban forest program could be a real challenge to improve the inclusiveness of the cities, to improve the quality of the life, and to build the comfort of the built environment in a time of changing world and a changing life. So I'm normally the one that is speaking, and let's leave the floor to the people that are making this happen. So I really thank you for this presentation, and thanks very much. And comes to Milan, this is what we are doing. I think it's amazing.
And to strengthen the synergies among the public and the private partnership.
need to work together to have a better quality and better tree system and to increase the heritage of the green metropolitan area. In order to work out with this research, we divided the research in different parts. Basically, we have four areas that are devoted to the analysis of the condition, and one of these parts will be strongly devoted to the mapping of the existing condition in order to improve and implement this challenge of having a better and increasing number of trees in the metropolitan area. We will need to work within our networks and expand our network in order to involve not just the citizens, the different stakeholders, the municipalities, and to work out in this incredible global network that are here, for example, at the World Forum on Urban Forest, in order to strengthen and to have best practices to talk with us and to share the knowledge. And then to work a vision together with our colleagues for the metropolitan areas. And then we want to improve a system of indicators in order to measure the impact of our project. We will have pilot projects throughout the research towards 2030 in order to see these pilot projects as living lab in order to understand how the model works, how the trees are working, which kind of trees we need to plant and in which condition. And then we will analyze and benchmark in the economical instrument. The particular part, the area of mapping will be devoted and will be done by the Laboratorio di Simulazione Urbana Politecnico, and Eugenio will briefly present the activities.
Thank you, Maria. So our task is also a technical task. You'd like to better understand what's already out there and how we can map the progress of our work. So it seems quite easy. You just take a picture of from satellite images. You try to account how many trees we have, but this is really not possible. It's very complicated. Even if in the Lombardy region we have a very advanced topographic database, but even if and also global service that maps all the trees, but this doesn't take into account a lot of things like private trees. So what is the contribution of private owners? This is a huge contribution. And moreover, every commune, so every municipality has a different way to count trees, to map trees and so on. So it's quite complex. So what our aim is not only to understand what is already there and how we will increase and make progress on trees, but also try to find a methodology which allows us to monitor also what we are doing, so to evaluate, and something which can be really agile, that also in 10, 15, 20 years can be reused easily. And technology is changing fast, so we are trying to map the different modalities that we have today for counting trees or canopy, tree canopy, which is the other indicator. So our work is based on different steps. So the first of all is to try to count this baseline, to assess this baseline of tree canopy, so what is out there in 2018. And then we're gonna start counting trees. So what do we add to this existing landscape? We're gonna use surveys out to municipalities, asking them what is your contribution. But also we are going to also add the contribution by everyone, so by citizens, by companies, by municipalities through an app that is going to be developed later. And then from 2019 beyond, we're going to start this monitoring of tree canopy. And then using data that comes from satellite images and data that comes bottom up from surveys, from the app and so on, we're going to establish a sort of hybrid monitoring of what's gonna also to count the trees or make estimations out of it. These are some of the numbers that we already start collecting. These are almost precise, but as I said, it's not really the real map of what we
plant trees for newborn people. So these are the ones that we are going in particular to start talking to from the very beginning. And this is these are the areas of part of Ecolosu, mostly, and then Parco Nord, of course, and then other public parking red in the city of Milano. So as I said, with some satellite images, we can really do a lot. We can start from very well-known ways to calculate the vegetation mass, to normalize the difference vegetation index and DVI, but this is just something that tells about how green is the territory, but it doesn't tell you the height, so we cannot really easily distinguish among trees and lawns and bushes and so on. And moreover, as you see from this map that we elaborated, green and heat islands, so red is where hottest spots are in the province. Of course, these are very correlated, so vegetation and temperature. And then we try to establish a model for heat island. Piero Pellizza already presented somehow, so we can really see and assess the contribution of vegetation, even if used and small scale vegetation within the city context is really important. And in very hot season or during heat waves, you can have a significant degrees of difference among very close parts of the city, like almost 2 degrees during the day and even 3 and 4 at night within the dense context. So we are trying to start all this mapping and also using different data sources, LUSAP, which is a land use map, and then we have topographic database. And so we try to use different hybrid ways of composing things. So of course we have difficulties, technical difficulties that I will skip for you. But it's a quite opportunity also to advance with technology and with mapping. And so we are going to work on this part. So of course we have the other point is that we have cheap data and expensive data. We try to use as much as possible the free and open source data, like the one we can get from satellite images. Of course, if we had LiDAR data, we had the LiDAR flight, it would be much more precise, but it's still a bit expensive, and we cannot have a LiDAR flight every year. To map the progress, so we are trying to use different technologies, as other cities are doing.
And I would just like to add that we don't only we work on satellite images and mapping, but we will do qualitative research by also this is just some images that shows also the importance of then going to the field and check out whether is there a real perception of this situation. And I will go very, very quickly because I want to really give the floor to our guests. But the importance also is to have a lot of meetings with all the different stakeholders that are involved, not only at the local level, but at all the levels that are engaged in the green and more generally the environmental sector, which is very much important for us. And this is some of the workshop that we've done so far among us. And also to benefit from the fact that particularly the city of Milan has these two amazing network, 100 resilient cities, and Bloomberg Associates are in the city of Milan, and we really want to engage with them in order to work in synergy, which is also one important thing for this research. We cannot do this alone. We need to do this all together. Otherwise, we won't make it. I will close this small discussion by also strengthening what Piero was mentioning. If this challenge seems to be very hard, but if we consider that each of the 134 municipalities will plant 2,000 trees every year, we will make it. If we plant a new tree for each of the newborn in the 10th year, we will have 300,000 new trees. And if one of us living in the metropolitan area will plant a tree in the next 10 years, so one tree by each person, we will have 3 million new trees in our metropolitan area. So I will definitely give the floor to our amazing guest, which I really thank to be here. It's, I know you're very busy and I very much appreciate the fact that you want to share your information and your knowledge with us. I will start with Riccardo Gini and then I will, we will pass the microphone up to. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Madam Chiara. I'm terribly sorry for the English speaker, but I think I only speak Italian because I have only 10 minutes to tell a long story. Then my English is not so fluent, it's a joke, it's because I don't know English. Then, from now, I speak Italian, okay? Because my presentation, actually, my presentation is in English. Then you can see something in the presentation, but I prefer to speak in Italian because I am sure that I say the right thing and not the spaghetti English. Okay. Well, the presentation is okay. I switch to Italian. It's quite hard. Comincio a parlare in italiano perché mi intrattengo un po' più facilmente. Vedremo quando prima o poi riuscirò ad aprire il PowerPoint questa lunga storia del Parco Rock che è cominciata negli anni 70, nel 70, proprio nel 1970 un decreto prefettizio individua l'area che vedremo come area da mantenere a parco metropolitano, una parola che quasi non si conosceva. Nel 74 nasce la Regione Lombardia e nel 75 il Parco Rock viene dichiarato parco regionale. Era carino vedere le immagini, facciamo il possibile per farvele vedere, perché sostanzialmente quello che devo raccontare a chi non lo conosce, anche se in sala ce ne sono tanti che già lo conoscono, che Parco Nord, a Parco Nord non c'era neanche un albero, cioè il Parco Nord è un'area disegnata a tavolino ma in cui non c'era nessun albero piantato. E devo dire che da quando è stata pensata questa cosa, ancora forse negli anni 60, nel 70 con le sue diciamo, definizioni dal punto di vista urbanistico, fino al 1983 non sono stati messi in moto delle piante, sono stati fatti dei progetti, sono state fatte una serie di studi, di analisi necessarie, poi quando però il progetto era pronto si è visto che costava una cifra assolutamente non plausibile, perché il primo grande costo che doveva affrontare il Parco Nord era quello dell'acquisto delle aree. Eravamo in epoca di mutui che andavano con una grandissima velocità dal punto di vista degli interessi, quindi le amministrazioni che pure avevano fatto questo passo importante di acquistare delle aree non erano in grado di finanziare un progetto vero e proprio. E qui il parco è stato fermo per molti anni, fino a che il parco, dico dal punto di vista istituzionale, è un ente completamente pubblico, è un ente in cui il Comune di Milano ha il 39% delle quote, la città metropolitana ne ha il 40% e il restante 21% le quote sono messe nei comuni limitrofi. Però appunto fino al 1983, anno per noi decisivo nel cambiamento della strategia, non era stato messo ancora neanche un altro. Ah, traduce. No, ma allora fai parlare in inglese, no, così se no mi ammorbiamo. I try to speak in English. When I jump, I apologize, but my English is what I can. the next one, please. Also in 1964, the next one, Holmes.
€35,000 per hectare and 25
from 25 to 45 euro per hectare. It depends if the wood is irrigated or not. But I see that plants is not enough to make a forest, because it's important to study the evolution of the forest, and then we have to cut for the first plot, for the first plot we have to cut many trees, because when in 1983 the knowledge about the urban forest was not so good, and then there were some mistakes about the technical plantation. Then we had to correct these mistakes, and then we had to cut many trees, also to monitoring the situation. Please, the next one. This is the situation. Then we, for example, during the monitoring, we found two species of mushroom or fungi, I think it's better, Photosphaeria oidea and Viscognata mediterranea, two fungi species that was very dangerous for the woods. In collaboration with the University of Bari and Florence, we studied this problem, we solved the problem. The change of the condition. I think that also in this forum we talked about the Eco Food Project, that is a project with Ersat and other Slovenia companies that stay. The goal was to increase the knowledge about the role of the urban and the peri-urban forests, to increase the knowledge about the ecosystem service, and to create a model to monitoring this forest, and create a manual about the urban forest management. Next, please. But Marcolotto is not created just to build a forest. It was designed to transform and mend the territory. To mend the territory is necessary to build some bridges inside the park. You see that the three bridges that overpass the big roads that are in the park, and also the other bridge outside the park to overpass the other big roads, the highway, the other roads to join the Pamplona to the other park. The next one, please. To the east side towards the Megalarogamba, to the southwest side of the Afori, and the west side to Pamplona Rossa, and the connection are with the cycle paths. You see the map that you can see the all direction, not in the southern side, because the south is Milan, but there is another tower to tell us about this. To restore the waterways, it's important to restore the waterways. We have two important waterways. One of these was in this condition. It is the same as Oliva when I arrived at the park. And from the condition we arrived in this situation, the quality of water is not so good now, because it's not our task, but we have to change the quality of the river, the benches of the river. We bring it new water bodies. There's the little one, this is the big one, where the Lago di Bruzzana is about half a hectare, and the other one is 2 hectares of water. The other thing, the important thing, that the Parco Rota is not only a forest, but direct management, the right can we design a special system to manage the park, and we have all the trees of the park are inside this this specific software we created, and we can manage all the maintenance, so the trees or the shrubs, the other all the things with, and permit to our technician to arrive with the companies that work with us to arrive to pay the fee for the maintenance in without paper, with also in an informatic project, informatic way. That is an important data. 2 million people, 2 million visitors stay in Parco Nord in during a year. And we have also many species. We go quickly because I have this Aleatiana 1 minute to finish. Then I will finish. No, this is important. That's 30 seconds. I read what they wrote, and we paved the way to build a recreational, cultural, educational service development, promoting sustainable economic activities, promoting opportunity for young, creative and dynamic entrepreneurship, provide opportunity to qualify volunteer work, encourage citizen involvement, encourage citizens' responsibility to crowdfund campaign. We have to go very quickly for the. This is an example. Too long. I don't have the time to explain about the Santa Barbara. This is the environmental education. There are other activities with family. We go. And the other activities. We go quickly to the cost, because I would like to spend some words about the cost. If they. This is a civil servant, very important for us. Not civil servant, I don't know any question. It's a bit too cheap. And this is another experience that is important, but I don't have time to speak. We have more than 650 family gardens. We have 140 one ecological montagne. Italian is not that spent more than 25,000 hours of volunteer. The campaign of fundraising, we started in 2015, and then we increased our income. This is too complicated to explain. How much I would like to underline this. In the Parc Nord, until 1973, now, last year, cost about $60 million in and the other and 78 millions in spese correnti. That is two numbers, but I would like to compare this in green infrastructure to another infrastructure, not green, gray, one of the less important in Lombardy, I think, so not so important in Lombardy, that is the Pedemontana. And then if you compare costs, you discover that the Parco Nord is cost at 2 kilometers or more, little more to the 2 kilometers in Conto Capitale, and less than 3 kilometers in Conto Corrente. That is important to reflect to this data, because when we speak about the gray infrastructure, we can imagine some cost, but when you speak about the green infrastructure, all is very I think this is the cost per meter food, one the pivot, the most actor to create the next one, please. The Parco Metropolitano, our dream, our goal. I think that this is a very strategic project for the metropolitan city of Milan, and we think that we have the experience and also the capacity to create this important project. I think it's finished.
These are the trees we have. about 500,000 at the moment, more or less. Half of them are in the woods and deforestation area. Some others are in the parks, and a lot of them along the streets. You can see we have some ornamental trees and many, many types, many species. We only see someone on the other. You can see a longer list, but it's not all what we have. It's just an example. If you go on Jumbo Valley, you can have all the species with all the sites. What are we doing this year? Towards the goal, we are going to plant 16,000 trees in the United Park. The change for the ones we are going to plant, because some of them died, so we replace them and we plant new trees. 16,000 is a very big deal, because all of them has a project, so you see the map and then you see another map with specific project. It's not only the city of Milan, but it's collaboration with Parco Nord, who has a project as well in Milan, Bosco Città, Italia Nostra, who work with us to have funds from the region for a specific project for construction of green infrastructure and green connection. What is very important in Milan is to connect all the trees we have to enhance the forest of green. So we're going to plan, but it's not important the number. For us, it's very important where, how, the quality. So any of the site is a project. I can only show someone. This is a new area in the north. Parco Diano is an existing park, so we made a project. You see the upper part, the more light green one, and it's just a suggestion. It was for Milano 2030, just to see now what it is, what it can be. I absolutely must say to everyone, when you plant a tree, you do not have a big tree, so we have to wait. So it's now, and within time, we will have this result. This is near Bosco Città. This is Cava di Mugiano, which is a particular site in the agricultural area where we try to respect the context and the characteristic of the site specifically, with different different type of trees and different type of plantation. So go, Shirley Gratis, another step of the project we have with Parco Nord. This is a square. What we are trying to do is to put, as I'm in charge only of green areas and not of gray areas, what we are trying to do is to put trees where I can on the gray infrastructure. And, well, on the other side with the Bloomberg system, we are trying to cooperate with another direction to find a way to use all the projects about gray infrastructure to enhance the number of trees along the streets, which is the most polluted site in land, the most polluted place, and the most awful as well, and full of cars and parked cars. This is another project we are carrying on with ERSA, Regione Lombardia, so many other partners. We never work together. All the partners just bring their own expertise. This is the parking, existing parking. We have many in Milan, which is very sad and hot and polluted. So this is how we try to put where we can at the moment green in gray areas. This is
is another site with an existing but near the intersection. And this is part of our planting plan, but it's very, I'm very linked to this project because it's the first project in Milan of federal remediation. It's a land which is owned by the municipality and actually rented to agriculture farmers who carry the families. But there was a pipe, oil pipe, which was broken, and so we had it was polluted. Annie was the owner of the oil pipe, and they didn't feel themselves responsible. They asked for a project, a remediation project, with phytoremediation. And as I'm particularly interested and fond about it, I said, okay, yes, we try. So we see, I'm not the expert, so I just show you a few pictures of two techniques, two strategies, phytoremediation and biopile. Just to see what it is, they use trees and lupinus and mice, just winter and summer, and bacteria and fungus, all combined to see if nature can fight pollution. So we have an experimental time and then we will see what the results will be. But it's very important because Milano is very polluted. The soil in Milano many times has broken. So it would be very important to find new strategies, alternative strategies. And so we see the biopile. Well, ask me a question about the remediation. Go. So this is the area at the moment and what it will be during the phytoremediation. During the remediation, normally we see very long line of trucks just excavating, taking soil, bringing it away, and then other trucks coming. So this is how we would like to be remediation in Milan. Finish. Oh no, work in progress. As we have to plant 16,000 all over Milan at the moment, we see the contractor, we have a global service. So I just put it here, few pictures of all the men working all around parks, streets, and everywhere. So if you come to Milan and you see someone planting, that's why.
Give the floor to Maria Pizzarra, our friend from Parco Agricolo. interna e la parte invece più prossima alla città, l'equilibrio ecologico dell'area metropolitana, la funzione e culturale ma anche ricreativa, perché il parco è ricco di numerosissimi monumenti tutelati, e infine, come ultimo ma non meno importante, che è il motivo principale per cui viene creata l'area protetta, è quella di tutela e valorizzazione dell'attività agricola.
As I told you before, PARC was founded in 1990, so we're a bit younger than the PARC Nord. The PARC was established just to fulfill a couple of functions. First of all, the recovery and the protection of the area, which are located between the city and agricultural areas. To create a sort of balance, an ecological balance with respect to the urban area, to enhance, to have also recreational function, because inside the area there are some important monuments, and also to protect and enhance the agricultural activity.
Ettari di territorio, come dicevo prima, di cui 38.000 sono coltivati, con una presenza di circa 1.000 aziende agricole, tutte attive. Ma che tipo di agricoltura si sviluppa in quest'area? È quella che viene chiamata comunemente agricoltura periurbana, cioè un'agricoltura che ha un rapporto che viene denominata in questo modo proprio perché è vicina ai centri abitati e perché sostanzialmente prova a trovare delle relazioni con essa. Per due motivi importanti. Uno legato al fatto che l'agricoltura di prossimità o l'agricoltura periurbana permette la conservazione dei suoli, e dall'altro perché prova a trovare anche relazioni positive con i consumatori, con la città o con i centri abitati, in termini sia di fruizione che di fornitura di servizi agroalimentari, fruitivi, ma anche di restituzione di aria verde e quindi positiva rispetto al tema che stiamo trattando.
I said that the surface on the area is about 47,000 hectares, 38 out of 47 are cultivated. We've got around 1,000 farms which are active in the area, and it's a peri-urban agriculture, which means it's an agriculture which takes place close to the town. It's looking for a specific relationship with the town, with the cities, in order to enable the preservation of soils, and it also looks for a relationship with the consumers. For which it develops some services, agri-food services and recreational services to make available green areas.
Entrando adesso proprio nel tema degli interventi di forestazione, su questa mappa sono localizzate tutte le aree su cui in questi anni siamo intervenuti. Il maggiore problema, la maggiore difficoltà che abbiamo incontrato è proprio la natura stessa del parco, cioè trovare delle aree che non fossero interessate all'agricoltura per poterle riqualificare, riforestare, e quindi siamo stati costretti nel corso degli anni ad andare ad acquistare e recuperare queste aree che erano per esempio utilizzate con usi impropri, che erano ex cave, che erano aree abbandonate, e quindi sono state acquistate all'uso pubblico dell'ente gestore che è Città Metropolitana, e su questi poi sono stati realizzati gli interventi che sono localizzati su questa mappa.
And to carry out the forestation, we had to carry out the forestation measures. You see what we did on this map, the pictures. The difficulty we had in this case was connected to the kind of park we are talking about. So we had to look for areas which were not dedicated in order to agriculture to go on a period of forestation, and we had to buy some areas
I primi interventi risalgono a questo grosso progetto che ha visto un interesse, è stato realizzato grazie ad un accordo tra la Regione, il Ministero Ambiente e il Ministero dell'Economia e ci ha permesso di lavorare sui primi 150 ettari, realizzando progetti di forestazione a rete su 19 diverse aree, con finalità diverse perché alcuni di questi hanno permesso anche di recuperare delle aree, come dicevo, abbandonate. Passiamo alla prossima immagine e vi faccio vedere i risultati. Queste sono le aree che abbiamo acquistato, che dicevo prima. Gli interventi sono stati realizzati in collaborazione con ERSAF e la prima immagine che vedete è un lago di cava abbandonato che è stato totalmente recuperato, forestato, che oggi viene usato dalle persone che vivono nell'intorno, ma anche da chi arriva dalle aree più esterne. Il progetto aveva anche la finalità di creare delle connessioni, quindi di creare, di provare a trovare le vie per creare corridoi ecologici e delle connessioni, che è una delle nostre finalità principali, come dicevo prima.
First, to carry out the first works, first interventions, we had to work in cooperation with the region, with the Ministry of the Environment and Economic Ministry on the first area of 150 hectares. We focused on a thing of 90 plots where we wanted to achieve different goals. Some of the areas were abandoned, as I said before, and you can see in the picture the results of our work. Certain areas, as I told you, had to be bought, and we worked in cooperation with ERSAF. You mentioned the picture of a lake, which had been abandoned, but which has been made available after our intervention. And the project aims at creating this sort of connection between agricultural areas and the towns, and at the creation of ecological corridors.
Questi sono gli impianti realizzati dire nell'area che vi ho descritto prima, e questo è lo stato dei luoghi oggi, reso fruibile alla cittadinanza. Altro intervento che è l'ultimo nato in casa riguarda un'area posta ad ovest del parco. Si tratta di un fontanile di una zona molto particolare, si tratta di una zona umida sostanzialmente, e particolare, dicevo, perché tutelata dall'Unione Europea come zona di conservazione speciale.
Okay, in the picture you can see our our activity and our actions and what the results of our actions were. This area was made available for citizens, for inhabitants of the city. And then we've got another one, the last one, in the west part. It's a quite particular area since there was a resurgence and also wetland. And it's also a very specific area because it's protected by the European Union.
Questa è l'area su cui siamo intervenuti. Ci troviamo, come potete vedere, in un'area immersa nella matrice agricola, che è quella tipica di questo parco, dove siamo intervenuti con questo intervento di forestazione che è stato ultimato nella primavera del 2018, 4 ettari e mezzo di nuova forestazione con un impiego di 7.800 piante, realizzato in collaborazione con i colleghi di ESAF. E la cosa che tengo a segnalare è che è stato possibile fare questo intervento grazie all'utilizzo di economie, di fondi che provenivano dalla trasformazione di un altro bosco, che ci ha permesso appunto di generarne uno nuovo.
Okay, that's how we worked. That's a typical agricultural structure of the area. So we started here our forestation in the spring 2018. We focused on 4.5 hectares. We planted about 7,800 trees in cooperation with ESAF. And the interesting part of it is that we were able to use money which had been available after the remediation of another wood, another forest.
E infine l'ultimo esempio che vi mostro non proviene direttamente nel territorio del parco, ma è realizzato da una nostra azienda agricola attraverso l'uso di siepi e filari. Come potete vedere, questa azienda ha completamente forestato i suoi campi con queste strutture di contorno che sono tipiche del paesaggio storico della nostra area, e grazie all'uso dei fondi dell'Unione Europea. E questo è un esempio che secondo noi mostra come anche gli agricoltori possono insieme a noi contribuire a valorizzare, a dare contenuto e a migliorare la qualità dei nostri ambienti. Tra l'altro questo intervento, come potete vedere, è proprio in margine del centro urbano. Io mi fermo qui e vi ringrazio.
The very last example you see here, our farm has been working in planting hedges and rows, which are typical for the area, thanks also to subsidies given by the European Union. And this is also very